like a breath of the northern air and rub those eyes. Real games with real fans. It's going to be exciting. We finally have reached week one of the 2021 season here at Jeff Diamond's Vikings and NFL Insider. We're going to take you through the league, but we're also going to break down a lot of things about the Vikings, including Brian O'Neill's new deal and, of course, the week one game at Cincinnati. I'm Jim Suhan. I'll be attending that game. Jeff will be analyzing from home and getting ready to give us another good show next week. So before we get to the game stuff, Jeff, as a general manager and somebody who closely monitors how the Vikings build their roster and make their decisions, what did you think of the Brian O'Neill deal?
I thought it was a smart deal, good deal for both sides. It really came in about exactly where I expected it to be for Brian O'Neill, who I think is a Pro Bowl caliber player already and probably will be voted to that at some point in his career very soon. He's one of the top four or five right tackles in the NFL. And I thought that deal would come in right around that $18.5 million per year on new money. And that's where Braden Smith is of the Colts. That's where Ryan Ramczyk, he's a little bit higher of the Saints. And those are probably the premier right tackles in the league right now. And so I think very deserving for Brian. He's the best offensive lineman on this team for sure. And as I said, one of the best in the league. And they can't afford not to keep good offensive linemen when the offensive line has been such an Achilles heel for this football team, as we know. And so, yeah. And I think also when I put on my agent hat, I say, yeah, it's about $92.5 million in new money, which is about 18 and a half a year. When I put on my GM hat, I say, well, he's also playing for about $2 million this year. So it's really $95 million over 6 years, not $92.5 over five. And that takes the average down to $16 million a year, thereabouts, a little more than that. And so I think from that perspective, I can understand why Rick Spielman and Rob Brzezinski feel good about the deal for O'Neill. And I can understand why O'Neill and his agents feel good about it. And so I think it's a fair deal and a smart deal and a guy they absolutely had to get extended. I felt the same way about Harrison Smith, even though Brian's only, whatever, 25, 26 years old. So there's a lot less risk in that, and especially for an offensive lineman compared to a 31, 32-year-old safety. But I thought the Harrison Smith extension also was well-deserved and smart to get done, because you look at that secondary, and it's all new except for Harrison.
Very good point. He's Jeff Diamond, former general manager of the Minnesota Vikings, former NFL executive of the year, former president of the Tennessee Titans during their glory year. I'm Jim Suhan from the Star Tribune. We do this show every week. We also do the Viking Update show with myself and John Krasinski for the writer's perspective on the Minnesota Vikings. One more thing from Jeff again, and Jeff also, you know, advises player agents as well. Anthony Barr, been a mystery all camp. Now we know it's a knee, and he is kind of practicing in seemingly a limited way, but it doesn't look like it's going to be a Danielle Hunter disaster story the way that turned out last year. What are you hearing about Barr? What do you expect from Barr?
Yeah, I watched him very closely yesterday when I was out at the Vikings facility watching the beginning of practice before they kicked us out. And by the way, Jim, back in the day, I know when you covered, we never kicked you out of practice, did we?
You did. It was back then, it was a little more at the discretion of the head coach and the team. And sometimes we could watch practice, but usually you did kick us out just because, and part of it is NFL media started growing. It was one thing when you had two beat writers and you trusted them and you knew they weren't going to tell anybody you were working on a flea flicker. But then as media grew and you had to kind of treat all media the same, it would have been a group of six or eight or 12, and you just can't have 12 people watching, you run practice. I understand why you don't do it.
Yeah, and I guess that's correct. I guess I'm thinking back to the Bud Grant years.
Right, that was different.
When we used to practice over at Midway Stadium and then Met Stadium, and it was always just the two beat writers were basically the only people that ever showed up anyway.
Right.
In those days. And so Bud didn't care. He wasn't worried about those guys. Whoever was covering the team at that time, that was going to write something, and even if Bud was even of the mindset that hey, even if they do say we're practicing a play, the other team doesn't know when you're going to run it. So,
right.
So what's the difference really? But anyway, but back to, yeah, yesterday watching Anthony Barr, and I thought he was moving pretty well in the portion I saw, which was just the individual portion, but he did have that sleeve on his knee, and we'll see how it holds up. I think also you got to factor in that he hasn't done a lot in preseason, as haven't a lot of starters on this football team, even though they've been in practice. But a game is different, as we all know, and going four quarters in a game is different. And so I think that's a huge factor in the opening game. I think that's why you see some big upsets week one, because some teams are just aren't, whether it's in top condition or they're facing weather conditions that are really hot. And that's going to be a factor the Vikings have to consider this week in Cincinnati. The forecast is 88 degrees on Sunday. Now, yeah, they practice in a lot of 90-degree weather this summer, but the last couple of weeks have been a little bit more mild. And you look at this team, and they just didn't play a lot in preseason. I've seen a lot of practices cut short. I think Zimmer's trying to save the team, which I think is smart, especially with a 17-game schedule this year. But depth is going to be tested early, and it's one of my concerns going into this opener for the Vikings because of the depth. And so how long can Anthony Barr hang in there? Is he going to get tired? How are they going to put a pitch count on Danielle Hunter, for example? It's really, there are so many interesting storylines to this game coming up in Cincinnati. When you think about, facing the Bengals, no big deal. Well, the Bengals have some players on that offense, and they're a little shaky on defense. It's going to be a very interesting opener, I think.
I agree, and we're going to get more into that. We want to thank our sponsors here at Jeff Diamond's Vikings NFL Insider, White Bear Lake Superstore, whitebearlakesuperstore.com, and BetUS, it's BETUS.com. Promo code is TNorth125 for all kinds of bonuses. I'll tell you more about that later. Also, we will do the BetUS.com picks of the week with Jeff at the end of this show. We'll get into the Vikings game, the Packers game, a couple of others that we find interesting. Well, you started breaking down the Vikings-Bengals game, and it is fascinating that way. We were, you know, on my show with Krasinski, the Viking Update show. You know, Krasinski picked the Bengals at least against the line, and I picked the Vikings. I just think the Vikings are a better team, and I figure if the Vikings win only six or seven games this year, I think this is one of them. But you did point out some interesting things. I mean, Joe Mixon is a load. Joe Burrow is a very good young quarterback. They have talent at wide receiver. We don't know how that talent's going to play out yet or whether Ja'Marr Chase is actually going to hold on to the ball when it's thrown to him, but they do have talent at wide receiver. And then, as you said, their defense is a little more spotty, but the Vikings' offensive line is not where it's supposed to be. I mean, well, again, we'll get into a more specific pick later in the show, but just what's your gut feeling about this matchup?
Yeah, I think it's a difficult game to really forecast from a lot of standpoints, but I think the key factor that I'm going to focus in on is the running game. I think whoever runs the ball better in this game is going to win the ball game. I like the Vikings interior defense. I'm really excited to see Dalvin Tomlinson and Michael Pierce together, and then Sheldon Richardson as a rotating guy with Armin Watts. I think they are so much better on the interior defensive line this year, and they're so much better outside just with Danielle Hunter back and Weatherly and Wanham. I think that front four and then the front seven with Kendricks back, hopefully he stays healthy if Barr can play close to his expected level. And Nick Vigil has played pretty well, and I think I like the front seven in this matchup in terms of being able to control Joe Mixon. And conversely, I think the Vikings are going to give a heavy dose of Dalvin Cook in this game. And it certainly makes sense. They're going against the number 29 overall run defense last year. The Bengals gave up 5.1 yards per carry, second worst in the league. And the only major change they made on the defensive line is Trey Hendrickson, who's really more he's an excellent pass rusher, had 13.5 sacks. He's going to be a load certainly for Rashad Hill to handle. The Vikings are going to have to chip on him. But I think they're going to come out of the gate with a heavy, heavy running attack in this game. And because you just have to expect the passing game is going to take maybe a little more time to come together, perhaps not, but Jefferson and Thielen hardly played in preseason. Jefferson didn't play. Cousins, very limited play. And breaking in a new pair of tight ends in Tyler Conklin, who's dealing with a hamstring. Hopefully he'll be okay. And Chris Herndon, who they had to trade for from the Jets after the Irv Smith injury. So I think it's going to be a heavy, heavy dose of Dalvin Cook. And if the Bengals go to 8 in the box, then that should open things up for the passing game. So I guess I'm tipping my hand on who I'm picking, because I think whoever runs the ball better is going to have a huge edge in this game. And I like the Vikings' chances with Cook and with that offense to be able to run the ball better than the Bengals can run it against the Vikings' defense. And but I think that's really one of the very, very key factors in this game. And there are a lot of other subplots, too. Who can pass protect better? The Bengals were bad in pass protection last year. And Burrow, in the 11 games he played, they gave up the second most sacks in the league. So that's a problem for them. They haven't really changed on the offensive line. And Riley Reiff is the newcomer. And who does he have to go against but Danielle Hunter, who he's certainly familiar with. But I like that matchup for the Vikings if Hunter is close to what Hunter can be. And as I said, I'm sure he'll be on some type of pitch count this week, and they'll be rotating guys, especially with the heat. But I certainly like him against Riley Reiff. And again, they'll have to probably help Riley in this matchup too.
I want to ask you more specifically about Barr and Hunter, two really big keys of this team. We do want to thank our sponsors, White Bear League Superstar. And by the way, let you know, this is part of the TalkNorth.com podcast. Network. We have tons of outdoor content. We have the best sports lineup in the Twin Cities. We have variety shows we're adding to our content. We have Raise Your Paws, which is a cool new show for pet owners, sponsored by Nutrisource. And also, we're planning on a couple live shows, September 14th, 6 o'clock, Pizza Luce downtown, the Cheryl Reeve Show. Cheryl's always great in those live settings. Also, September 22nd at the Eden Prairie Pizza Luce with Chin Music with LaBelle Neal and Roy Smalley. We'll get you more details on that show as we get closer. Also, you can follow us on Twitter at Talk North Pod to see the shows as they're released. The best way to listen to this show or any show on the network, subscribe to your favorite podcast app. It's easy. It's free. Highly recommend it. Right now, though, we'd like to thank our friends at White Bear Lake Superstore, whitebearlakesuperstore.com.
Yeah, thanks, Jim. And certainly, I love Pizza Luce. Tip for everybody, the Ruby Ray is great.
It is good. You're right.
Absolutely. But I'm always excited to talk about the White Bear Lake Superstore, Buick GMC. My longtime friend, the owner, Paul Rubin, his general manager, Charlie Guttrell, their great staff, Minnesota's number one volume Buick GMC dealer, 6 years running, with the best selection and with their super friendly premium team. Check out their great website, WhiteBearLakeSuperstore.com, and you'll see great offers on the new 2021 Buick Encore GX Essence. $1,800 dealer discount plus $1,500 purchase allowance and an additional $500 when you finance through GM Financial. Other great deals on Buick Encore GX Preferred and Select and the Buick Encore GX, or the Buick Encore Preferred. And the White Bear Lake Superstore is the Quigley 4x4 Van Superstore. They are a certified elite dealer. Only 7% of GM dealers make the cut. So visit in person at 3900 Highway 61 North in White Bear Lake or online at WhiteBearLakeSuperstore.com for all your vehicle needs and the premium experience. Buick GMC, we are professional grade.
We'd also like to thank our producer, Brandon Morton, who holds all this together, and our sales executive, Karen Cleary. You can reach her at K-C-L-E-A-R-Y at TalkNorth.com. If you'd like to arrange a live show, if you'd like to sponsor this program, or if you'd like to sponsor any of the shows at the network. We'll also tell you about BetUS. Again, it's BetUS.com. The promo code is TNorth125, TNorth125, with sports betting season in full force. You need a sports book with integrity and longevity like BetUS. You may already know this, but BetUS has been pioneers in the sports book industry for almost three decades, thriving and paying their loyal customer base. That's BetUS.com, and they have loads of bonuses. Join now or call 800-69-BETUS. That's 800-MY-BETUS. You receive 125% sign-up bonus by using the bonus code TNorth125. They have re-up and referral bonuses also. BetUS is known as America's favorite sports book for a lot of reasons. BetUS has all your NBA and NHL games with team and player props and loads of NHL futures and NFL odds up already. You can bet UFC matches and props, PGA golf and round matchups, and live betting on most sports, including golf. The online casino has hundreds of games, and the racebook has all your horse tracks. They have every bet type imaginable, and the sharp BetUS mobile platform is easy with full betting options. Follow my lead and get your phone, online, and social sports betting partner with integrity and longevity like I did. BetUS, you bet, you win, you get paid. BetUS, again, the promo code is TNorth125. So Anthony Barr, interesting conversation with a lot of the Star Tribune writers and stuff I've been hearing for years and through the grapevine out at TCO is that even though people like me and you and a lot of NFL analysts look at Anthony Barr and say, okay, you're paying a really high premium for a guy who doesn't make a lot of splash plays. There is a belief in that building that he is a key to running that defense and holding that defense together. Do you buy that?
Well, I do to a certain extent in terms of he's the signal caller. He gets the call from Zimmer and all that. But again, for 13 plus million a year, you expect a little more than just being able to relay signals from the head coach and some leadership on the field. That's all great. But how much is he available? He's missed games in the past few years with different minor ailments, and now he's got the knee he's dealing with. And so if you can't count on him to be in there, and then last year, of course, had to miss basically the whole year with the pec. So he's an injury risk. He's a high-paid guy. He doesn't make a lot of big plays in terms of forced fumbles, fumble recoveries, interceptions, sacks. And we kept hearing for a long time that, oh, yeah, he's going to be more of a pass rusher and has that great play in his history where he knocked Aaron Rodgers out for the season. And so I think we'd all like to see a little more of that, not necessarily saying knock players out, but maybe more sacks, more blitzes from a guy who is such a physical specimen. And I just question the deal. The moment he signed that contract, I questioned that contract because of his history. And I still question it to this day. And now, of course, he took a pay cut, which is probably warranted, and he's going to be a potential free agent next year. Honestly, I think this is probably his last year here. But then again, when Zimmer pounds on the desk and says, I got to have him, I guess I can't really say that with any surety that that's going to happen. So Anthony Barr he's kind of a mystery. And I know how much they value him and Zimmer values him, but we'd all like to see a little more out of him than what we've seen. And if that happens, so much the better for their defense, certainly.
My next question is, what is realistic to expect from D.L. Hutter? Because that's another thing I hear a lot out there is, oh, my God, he looks great. He's primed for a big season. But he is coming off missing an entire year. What can we expect from Hutter?
Again, I think when Zimmer keeps talking in these press conferences, he mentions this word unknown a lot. Mm-hmm. And I think that's an unknown to me. Is Daniil, he looks great. But again, there's going to be a little bit of a period of adjustment for him, we would assume. Now, maybe he'll come out of the gate strong against a poor pass-protecting team. But again, he'll probably get more attention, but he's used to that. So if Daniil is right, yeah, he's great. He's one of the top pass rushers in the league. He's worth the $20 million plus a year he's seeking in this next contract. But how quick that's going to happen is going to be really important for this team because they need the pass rush. When especially you look at all these changes on defense, basically 8 new starters and 9 new starters if Barr isn't in there, and an all-new secondary except for Harrison Smith. And there's going to be, I think, a little bit of an adjustment period for that secondary. And it could start this week, which is why I think it'll be a fairly high-scoring game. I think there's going to be big plays on both sides. But I still think Daniil Hunter, I believe that he's going to be a double-digit sack guy. I'm not sure he'll be the 14.5, 15 sack guy that he was this year. But he's still only 26, 27 years old. And I wouldn't be surprised either way. Jim, there are so many things about this football team. And I had a hard time figuring out, what am I going to pick their season record at? I know you're going to ask me that because there are just so many, as Zimmer says, unknowns.
Well,
is one. Barr is one. The secondary, Patrick Peterson. It's all over the map. And the offensive line, Rashad Hill, wow, he scares me. And Ole Udo, I like Ole, but it's still his first NFL start, his first season starting inside. Bradbury still needs to improve. Ezra Cleveland, I think, is a good player, but again, second year. Questions all over the map. And really the only not question is the dynamic duo wide receiver, Jefferson and Thielen, and can they get him the ball?
Right. The intrigue around that team is, like, I asked Zimmer two consecutive Wednesdays, I asked Zimmer a question and he gave me a really great and interesting answer. And two Wednesdays ago, I asked him, you know, like, man, does it feel like you're just putting out fires around here? And he said, it's been like that for 8 years. And he went on and on. And yesterday, we're talking here on Thursday morning. Yesterday, I asked him, hey, are you concerned about your depth? And he said, yeah, when you have all these high priced players, it's hard to fill in the rough. And it, you know, given that Spielman and Zimmer seem to be on the clock this year, we don't really know, but that it feels like this is a make or break year for them. It almost sounds like Zimmer saying, hey, you know, the way we've run this franchise, the way Spielman has handled the money, and the fact that he paid Cousins and paid so many of these high priced players, it's hard to fill out a roster. It's hard to have good depth. I think that's why you talked about how difficult it is to pick what this team might do, because they have high end players. But the high-end players are making so much money, they don't have much behind them.
Yeah, and that means that high-end players have to stay healthy, too.
Yep, which doesn't happen that often.
It is a concern, definitely. And we've already seen one major injury with Irv Smith Jr. And the other thing, as Zimmer said, is every team around the league is dealing with the same stuff. And that's true. And the Bengals go into this week. They have their high-priced corner, ex-Viking Trey Wayne. He's not going to play this week, which is good for the Vikings receivers that they don't have to face him, even though I don't think he was ever a player that was worth $14 million a year that the Bengals gave him. And so there's a lot of factors. And as you said, it makes it hard to predict, and the depth is a concern. But I think there are so many teams around the league that are in a similar boat. And we've seen what happens when a star such as Dak Prescott went out last year for Dallas and their team went down the tubes, and the Kansas City offensive line went and all got hurt at the end of the year, and they got thrashed in the Super Bowl. So things happen. And the other thing, what talking about the unknowns, how about the Vikings kicking game, Jim, which has been a source of angst around here forever. I think since Ryan Longwell had several good years, and now they give Greg Joseph a new holder this week in Jordan Berry, the new punter, who obviously he's a younger guy than Britton Colquitt. They like his potential as a punter, but it makes it tough for the kicker when you change the dynamic that they've been working on since April. The trio, and don't underestimate the timing of the kicking game. And so Greg Joseph has to break in a new holder this week with the opener coming up. And Greg Joseph's no sure thing, by the way, of course, because this is basically his first full season in the NFL. And he's been okay in preseason, and we'll see about him too. So, but then on the other side for the Bengals, they're starting, they have a rookie kicker who was a fifth round pick, McPherson, out of Florida. So there are a lot of subplots and storylines to this game. But again, I think it comes down ultimately to who can run it better, who can pass protect better, who can pass rush better, who turns the ball over, and which kickers can be more consistent in this game, and who handles the heat. It's going to be, I think, facing a Cincinnati team that's not a rival, it's really an interesting opener to me.
It really is. Yeah, I'm very intrigued by this. You know what? We're going to get some more NFL talk here, but it's also a good way to do NFL talk is to go ahead and do our picks and pick the Vikings record and the division standings, all that stuff. So, again, this is the BetUS Smart Bets of the Week. Jeff and I are going to offer our football opinions. We are not betting experts, so don't go bet the house on anything we say. We're just going to have some fun doing this. You should use the BetUS app for fun. Don't get yourself in financial trouble because of this. Just have some fun with it. Again, the promo code is TNorth125 for 125% sign-up bonus at BetUS.com. All right, let's start with this one. The Ravens on Monday night are giving 4.5 points against Vegas. Which way would you lean in that one?
Yeah, I think that that again, with Baltimore's problems at running back, it's going to put more pressure potentially on Lamar Jackson. Vegas is essentially breaking in a new stadium that they weren't able to do last year, just like the Rams and Chargers at SoFi in LA. And Vegas, incidentally, another interesting subplot to the season, they are requiring a proof of COVID-19 vaccination or a negative COVID-19 test within the 72 hours prior to the game. That's going to happen in Seattle, New Orleans, and in Vegas. And Jim, can you imagine the logistics of trying to get 65,000 people into a stadium and checking all their vaccination records?
Oh, man.
I mean, come on. How's that going to work?
Oh, brutal.
It's going to be brutal. It's just going to take forever for those fans to get in the stadium. But I think 4.5 is a little stout in this game. I think Baltimore can win this game, but I would take – you're saying Baltimore is a 4.5-point favorite, right?
Yes.
Yeah, I would take Vegas to beat that spread. But I think the Ravens win the game.
I think the Ravens win, and I think they win by like 10. I just don't like the Vegas operation. I think that Carr is kind of holding things together there, but I don't like the way they've run their operation. I think the Ravens outclass them. That's our first pick. Second pick, Green Bay Packers favored by 4 at New Orleans.
I think that if it was at New Orleans, that would be great for the Saints. Unfortunately for them, it's at Jacksonville because of the hurricane issues carrying over. And I think that's a huge detriment to the Saints to lose that Superdome home field advantage. The Packers really got lucky with that deal, unfortunately for New Orleans. And I think it makes Green Bay an easy pick for me in this game, even with the points in Jameis Winston's debut. I think the Packers are going to be able to win this game by a touchdown.
I am betting on the Packers in that one. To me, that's an easy one. And now, of course, the premier game we pick on this show, Vikings favored by 3 at Cincinnati.
Yeah, and again, I think for the reasons we've talked about, and I'm going to throw one other little curveball into this equation for the Vikings, is the new offensive coordinator, Clint Kubiak. It's his debut, and so, which is part of the reason I think Zimmer's going to be in his ear, run the ball, run the ball, run the ball.
Yeah.
But I like the Vikings in this game. I don't think it's going to be easy, and I think it could be fairly high scoring just because of the Vikings defense breaking in all these starters and the secondary having not played together as a unit in preseason. I think there are going to be a couple breakdowns. The Bengals have some weapons, as we've talked about. Ja'Marr Chase had trouble hanging onto the ball in preseason, but Tyler Boyd and T. Higgins are quality receivers, and Burrow is a very good young quarterback, and Zimmer talked this week about his accuracy, about his competitiveness, and I agree with all that, but he is coming off ACL injury, and he's going to be perhaps a little skittish if the pressure starts coming early, and I expect Zimmer to blitz him hard early on to try to get in his head, and so I think from all the standpoints I talked about, and I think a big day for Dalvin Cook, I think enough big plays from the receivers and Cousins. I'm going to go with the Vikings to win this game, and I'm going to say fairly high scoring, 34-27.
I think that's right in my ballpark. I'm going to go 31-20. I'm going to go 31-20. Vikings win this going away, but it might be difficult for first 2-3 quarters. All right, what are you going to pick the Vikings record to be?
Yeah, I think it's difficult because, as we said, there's so many variables, so many unknowns, and I went through the schedule and kind of charted it out, and I think that it really makes it also important for this opener. I think it's a really critical game to get the win in Cincinnati. One of the things about this Vikings schedule, one of the toughest schedules in the league, is they're playing two of the best divisions in the league in the crossover. They're playing the NFC West, which is, I think, the best division in the league when you look at those four teams. Almost any one of them could win the division, and except maybe Arizona is not quite at the level of the 49ers, Rams, and Seahawks. But wow, that division's loaded. And they're playing the AFC North, which is a really excellent division with Cleveland coming on, Pittsburgh, Baltimore. And they're playing arguably the worst team in that division this week, which is why they better get a win this week against the Bengals. And then they got a tough game next week in the desert where it could be 100 degrees against Arizona, a team that looks fairly formidable. And so as I looked at the season and I broke down the schedule, I kind of felt that they needed to split these first two games. Then they got two tough home games against Seattle and Cleveland, who are both quality teams. I think they'd probably split those games. And then they play Detroit and Carolina. I think they're 4-2 at the bye. And then the schedule gets really tough. Dallas, Baltimore, Chargers out in L.A., Green Bay, San Francisco, tough, tough stretch. And then the end of the season when they got a bunch of division games. So I'm going to put on my rose-colored glasses, Jim, and I'm going to be optimistic. I should call my purple glasses, and I'm going to say 10-7. I know a lot of people probably think I'm overly optimistic there. It could easily be turned around to 7-10 if they get a couple key guys hurt. But I kind of see a path where they could go to 10-7, maybe even 9-8 might make the playoffs this year. I still think they'll be chasing Green Bay. I think Green Bay, as I broke down their schedule, I see them about a 12-5 team. And I still think the Packers are going to win the NFC North. But if the Vikings get off to a good start, they can't start like last year when they started out 0-3. If they get off to a good start, I think they have a chance to make some hay and be a quality team, be a wild card team, and then let it rip in the playoffs. See what happens.
I'm picking 7-10. We'll see which one of us is right, and we'll keep reviewing all the aspects that will dictate what kind of record the Vikings have. Thanks to Jeff. Thanks to Brandon. Thank you for listening. We'll be back next week to review the Cincinnati game and preview the Vikings' trip to the desert. Thanks for listening to TalkNorth.com.